Good evening. I'm Xandra Eden, Executive Director of Diverse Works.
Hi, and I'm Ashley DeJoya, Curator of Diverse Works.
Thank you all for joining us tonight. We're delighted to be introducing two really brilliant artists and to talk about their newly commissioned projects, The Tender Interval by Baltimore artist Sara Dittrich and Nonplus, AKA Recycled Air by Houston-based artist Yui Nakayama.
Before we begin, we want to say thank you to the amazing artists who are here with us today for accepting the invitation to work with Diverse Works and who have also been so open and invested in adapting the work for the circumstances of the pandemic. We'd also like to thank our program assistant, Maya Nicole White, and Deputy Director, Jennifer Gardner, for their important contributions to these projects and for all of us working together to make these virtual shifts happen.
And our work is made possible through the contributions of many people, including Diverse Works staff, our members, and the generous support of the National Endowment for the Arts, the Texas Commission on the Arts, the City of Houston through the Houston Arts Alliance, the Brown Foundation, the George and Mary Josephine Hammond Foundation, the Heimbinder Family Foundation, the Hollyfold Foundation, Houston Endowment, the Bucher Charitable Fund, the Andy Warhol Foundation for the Visual Arts, and the Wortham Foundation. Thank you.
So tonight's program will last approximately an hour. First, we'll hear from artist Sara Dittrich, and then we'll hear from Yui Nakayama. And then we'll have a conversation with the artist, myself, and Xandra, before concluding with Q&A with all of you. Before we pass things to the artist, we wanted to provide a bit of background for why we're here today. Xandra and I started working with each artist over a year ago to develop new projects that would originally intended to be presented as two solo shows in the Match Gallery at our Midtown Arts location. We felt that the artists shared some clear correspondence, but we also felt that they each warranted a solo show. Thus, the gallery was supposed to be split down the middle, and we had devised a plan where each installation would have a separate entrance. And of course, this plan, due to COVID-19, shifted the artist concepts and had to be completely reworked because of the health and safety precautions and closures of the venue. The road has been bumpy, and we have truly overjoyed the resulting works by Sara and Yue, and are relieved to find that even through this time, with the planning and support, that they have found some fascinating formats to pursue their artistic endeavors. So I'm quickly going to introduce Sara's work. So I've, on a personal note, I've known Sara since 2018, when she came and talked to a course. A group of students at MICA. And so Sara is a Baltimore-based artist, interdisciplinary sculpture artist who builds introspective experiences that shift perspectives from passive seeing to active looking, from passive hearing to active listening. Dittrich uses musical thinking to illuminate the dynamic and unconscious rhythms of the body and the environment with diverse mediums that often include sculpture objects, musical performance, video, and interactive electronic media and technologies. Dittrich's studio practice is located in Baltimore, Maryland, where she lives and works and since receiving her Bachelor's of Fine Arts from Maryland Institute College of Art. Her work has exhibited at notable venues, including Baltimore Museum of Art, Washington Project for the Arts, DC, Urban Institute for Contemporary Arts in Grand Rapids, Missouri. And she's been selected for numerous residencies, including Bemis Center of Contemporary Arts, Sculpture Space, and the Fine Arts Work Center in Provincetown in May. So we're really excited to have Sara present on her work, and I'm really excited to see her virtual components after 2 years of conversations. Thank you, Sara. Now it goes to you.
Thanks so much, Ashley, and thank you to the rest of the Diverse Works team. And thank you everyone for joining tonight. I'm excited to share about my project. So I'm gonna just share my screen here. So I'm going to just kind of jump right in. The tender interval is really a result of the accumulation of many experiences that have been ruminating for me over the past several years. But I'm going to begin by briefly showing a few works, a few past works that give context to this new work. So this first work pictured here is titled Cadence, and it's a performance where each performer wears a heart pulse sensor on their finger, and then each drumstick taps to their individual heartbeats. And this work is the first time I started incorporating these kind of sensors into the body. And I was really interested at the time of these really focused on the body and the unconscious rhythms of the body and how the body could be a tool or like an instrument itself and also be like a tool for communication. And that slowly led to this next piece, Going Staying, which I'm just going to go ahead and play the little clip of this installation performance work here. So this work uses long range Bluetooth. It's about like a one or two, whenever I'm within a 1 or 2 mile radius of the drum is able to beat to my footsteps in real time. And at the time I was really interested in this text called Rhythm Analysis, written by Henri Lefebvre, who's a French philosopher. And one of my favorite quotes from that text is, "He listens and first to his body. He learns rhythm from it in order consequently to appreciate external rhythms. His body serves him as a metronome." And so the whole text is kind of thinking about ways we can kind of look at the world through this musical lens and through rhythm in order to interpret it. And I think as you'll see, that's like really influential in my work. And this next piece here is titled Score for Room. And in this first iteration pictured here was actually created at the Bemis Center residency program in Omaha, Nebraska. And I actually, in this work, I took black and white construction paper and covered my entire kind of live work apartment into this giant kind of sheet music, like life-size sheet music of sorts. And I basically lived with this paper for like 3 months, and over the 3 months of my residency, it accumulated all the kind of wears and tears of walking on it over those 3 months, and all the dust and dirt and kind of like the marks from my wheelie chair. And it just became this experimental music notation of sorts created by the body. Here's a shot of it actually like installed in my little live work apartment at Bemis. And then in another iteration for a gallery space at Washington Project for the Arts, I installed it again, but this time I created a false floor underneath where I actually embedded contact mics into the floor to help amplify the visitor's footsteps. So you can kind of see the amplifier there in the middle of the space. And over time, all the visitors' marks kind of like tore up the paper and left their marks to create this music score. And then this last work I'm going to share was created in 2019, last year, when I was a visual arts fellow at the Fine Arts Work Center in Provincetown, Massachusetts, which is on the tip of Cape Cod. And I was there, it's a 7 month long program, which was really great to really spend time and explore the place. And for those that don't know, Cape Cod is located kind of basically on the tip of this little peninsula. And while there, I was just became hyper aware of the landscape. It was kind of, it was constantly shifting. You're surrounded by sand dunes, which are changing shape in the wind. And then also there's a really large tidal range there. So daily, you could see the ocean rise and fall up to 14 feet. And so I'm going to play a little clip of this piece here, but you'll see kind of evidence of that. So this work really kind of signals a shift for me where I started focusing not only on the rhythms of the body, but started to see rhythms in the landscape and thinking about how our body can relate back to the landscape. And that really was kind of a turning point and leads into this new tender interval work. And so since then, I've been thinking about all these different kind of natural cycles we exist in, such as the oxygen cycle, where we breathe in oxygen and give off carbon dioxide, and then plants are able to take in that carbon dioxide and turn it back into oxygen. Also thinking about the water cycle and how most of our body is made up of water, and just kind of really kind of reflecting on these kind of different cycles that we exist in the landscape. And then here's just a quick shot of my studio space because I always think it's fun to see what people's workspaces look like. And this is back in May when I think we were still kind of hopeful something could happen in the Houston Gallery, but things changed as they all did. And here we are on Twitch. So for the tender interval, it kind of turned into a live performance series that is streamed on Twitch TV, which is a live streaming online platform. It's typically used by gamers, but and there's like other ways obviously of using it too. So I'm going to, I guess, explain this first performance. The work is really two different performances. This first one here, I'm just going to go ahead, I think, and play a little clip of what it looks like. And I should say these are like very brief clips. You can find the recordings and also tune in for a live stream on Twitch later.
Where are you? Gently turn your face towards the sun. If you are standing, lay down in your soul. Lay on the earth.
So that was just a brief clip. And as you could hear, it features a special soundtrack that was commissioned by Houston-based sound artist Lisa Harris, titled Undulated Vector, Ray's Song for Earth. And that kind of soundtrack, it was important for me to have and to work with Lisa in order to kind of help create the certain meditative atmosphere for the work and help kind of guide the viewer through this durational performance. The other element of this piece, as you can see here, there's a lot of layers. The other element is I'm wearing a heart monitor, so you can see what my heart rate is in real time as I'm performing live. There's also a sensor on the treadmill that is sensing every footstep I take. And if you look closely at the footage, basically one footstep equals one frame of video. So my pace is driving how fast the time lapse is happening. And then as you saw in the recording, there's different time lapses that occur, and the way the time lapses change is actually through audience interaction. So as you can kind of see on the right here, in the Twitch chat, users are able to type in a command, a special custom coded command that was created by an engineer I worked with, Devin Bray, who helped me with a lot of the engineering for these performances. But you can type in change scene and that will change the kind of time lapse you're looking at. And these are all time lapses that I filmed from various places. I have a few kind of behind the scenes of that here. I was able to make it to Texas last fall and try out a few there. So I did manage to get some from there. And then here's just a little behind the scenes of the sensor testing in progress when we were working on it. It's basically an accelerometer that senses when the bed of the treadmill moves up and down with the footstep. And then the second performance features a performer where they place their hand on the table and a heart pulse sensor senses their heart pulse, and then water from this IV stand drips in time to their heart pulse. And then on the other side, I created a version for viewers to interact with where if they type in different versions of drip drop into the chat, then that will trigger this side to drip. And so again, it's kind of like a weird or like just a combination of all these different cycles and rhythms that kind of overlap to create this space to slow down and relate back to the earth. And then just a few detail shots. And here's a little behind the scenes of, you can see a little bit behind me right now on my webcam, but because I wasn't able to get high-speed internet in my studio, and the Houston thing didn't happen. This is what my living space looks like right now, a little behind the scenes. And then the last element of the exhibition is I created a booklet, a meditation guide of sorts that goes along with the live stream performances that you can find a free PDF download on the Diverse Works website. I also am making a limited edition that you can purchase. But the booklet is made 100% out of cyanotype prints. And this was just a really nice way to have something tangible for the exhibition. And also the process of cyanotypes, I feel like fit perfectly for this exhibition with, it's kind of a collaboration with the sun because you use the sun to expose an image. Here I'm featuring a page that has a quote that inspired the title for this exhibition. And then just a little process behind the scenes of the leaves I collected while I was creating the booklets. And then just last slide, we have several more opportunities for you to tune in to a live stream and interact. It's on my Twitch channel, which you can find the link here. Also, it's all on the Diverse Works website. But I'll be streaming weekly, 7 to 9 p.m. Central Time Thursdays, 12 to 2 p.m. Central Time Saturdays. Basically now, so tomorrow night through Saturday, November 14th. So I hope you have a chance to check it out. And up next, we have Yue, and here's the info for her upcoming event. So if you guys just want to take a screenshot to have that info all in one place, that'd be great. So thanks for listening. And I think it's back to Zandra.
Thanks, Sara. That was great. Stop sharing. Now we'll hear from Yue Nakayama. Yue is a Houston-based artist, filmmaker who's had screenings and exhibitions at many different sites, including at the Lawndale Art Center here in Houston, at Moon Mist in Houston, the Museum of Fine Arts Houston, the ICA Philadelphia, and the Visual Arts Center, University of Texas at Austin. And she also performed a live piece as part of Diverse Works 12 Minutes Max series in 2018 with her partner, Ronnie Yates. She also holds a BFA from Denison University and an MFA from the University of Pennsylvania. She's the recipient of the Arch and Ann Giles Kimbrough Fund of the Dallas Museum of Art and Houston Arts Alliance Artist Grant. She's done residencies at Skowhegan, the CORE program here in Houston, which is part of the MFA Houston program, and the Lighthouse Works Fellowship. Her work encourages really a reflection on the interconnectedness of belief systems and procreation and basically like extinction various emotions connected to maternity. I think this video that she created, which will also become a live event on October 29th, really is taps into all of those issues in like a really strong and interesting way. So I'm super excited to introduce you to UA and hear more, have all of you hear more about her work. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Yue. Thank you, Zandra, for a lovely introduction. And then thank you everyone at Diverse Works to make this exhibition, talk, everything happen, come together. And then thank you everyone for tuning in, spending your time actually listen to me talk. Okay, let me pull up the slide. So my exhibition with Diverse Works Nonplus consists of, two parts. One is the online programming or online viewing, that one of the video piece called Recycled Air, its first iteration is on view through their website during the course of the exhibition. And there's also, I'm just gonna come back to the video, but there's also another one-day in-person event, which is really exciting during this time, outside screening and a sculptural installation on Thursday, October 29th, 6:30 to 9 p.m. at the Waterworks in Buffalo Bayou Park, which is this area above Cistern. And there'll be screening around 7 p.m., but then also the piece will be looping the entire time during this event. So please come check this out during the event hour. So I made a 2-3 minutes trailer for the piece that I'm currently showing online on the Diverse Works website, for the people who haven't seen, you get some ideas.
Do you know how close people are to the edge of the abyss? Do you know how close people are to the edge of abyss? The human body is resilient. Even if we've given up on ourselves, our body is still there. I watched the news later that day and saw the image of the towers falling. I wonder who owns the pain of a catastrophe. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday, dear me. Happy birthday to me. I think being a YouTuber is the only solution for this increasingly punishing nature of the American and global economy.
Well,
Do you know how close people are to the edge of the abyss?
Sorry about the little mishap. Let me get back to the
birthday to me. Happy birthday to me. Happy birthday, dear me. Happy birthday to me. I think being a YouTuber is the only solution for this increasingly punishing nature of the American and global economy. I like to have grilled cheese for breakfast. When something's wrong, defend yourself with whatever you can find. The cruelty of the world doesn't exist outside of us. We are just spending so much of our time trying to feel better.
It's hard to die alone.
Let's talk about productivity. What is love? Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more. Baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt me no more. And constipation is our only enemy. My chiropractor told me that I have too many toxins in my liver and I need a detox. I wonder if I can detox my soul.
Okay, so that was a 3-minute trailer from the first iteration of the piece that's on view on the Diverse Works website. And you can also, if you live in Houston, come see the final iteration, the final screening, outside screening on the end of October. And I want to talk about the process of how, you know, the process of making this piece and then also a few earlier pieces that maybe inspired me. Or, you know, when you make a new piece, it's always, it's addition to what you have been doing in the past. And so I guess, Zandra invited me to, you know, work on a project at Diverse Works. Maybe a year ago, I was really excited for the opportunity. And we're talking about a few of my past pieces. And I was also thinking about Diverse Works as this platform where there's lots of focus on performance art and experimental performative gestures. I was thinking about, and I'm a, you know, filmmaker, artist, but also I have done performance in the past, and I was thinking about myself as performer, but also like performance, how I work with performance in my own work. And here there are videos too from two pieces. The two on the top is from Love in the Time of True Blue. This is a first kind of experimental narrative interview project. I interviewed all those people. We learned this like dance move together, and we danced and talked about life, and there's different parallel story being mixed together. So that's something I guess you can definitely see where the work I made, you know, came from. This communal group exercise dancing gesture I was also interested in the past. And the two picture on the bottom is from the piece called Wake Me Up in When It's Gold Again. And for this piece, it's kind of funny, absurd narrative that is juxtaposed with this strange behavior, like shark swimming around the lobster. You can see the little shark fin on the, you know, back of this swimming person people and two people hugging in between two poops. It's kind of this absurd sense of humor, but a strange poignant poetry narrative in the background. And I think that kind of also is really reflected in the current piece I made. And so these two were the project that I guess I worked with performer people to perform in front of the screen for my project. And I was also looking at the project that I as performed in the piece. This green screen one is kind of early piece. I was making different gestures while the story is being narrated on the subtitles. And then the picture on the right is, this was the one I guess Zandra mentioned in the introduction, the 12 minutes max at the Diverse Works. And I actually transformed this piece, Love in the Time of True Blue, into a 12 minutes performance piece, like live performance piece, and performed it at the event. It was a really interesting experience to like, you know, tap myself back into performance, but also to transform existing project and present it in a different form. So I was thinking about all those different projects I made. So I was asked for, invited to make a show a year ago, I guess. And during the creative process, I mean, many people work different ways, but I think about work a lot before I make work. And I spent like 8-9 months thinking about the ideas, thinking about the concepts, thinking about the content, thinking about everything. And I guess initial idea was, I think I was really interested in using this like a performance platform of Diverse Works to do either like in-person performance in the gallery space or there, you know, I had a possibility to perform in one of the match space as a ticketed event. There's like different possibilities. And I was kind of back then interested in the idea of gym culture, but not in individual gym culture, but I have been going to YMCA's group exercise class religiously since I came to Houston like a couple years ago. And then, cause you know, it's a core culture, there isn't that much opportunity to be with like a stranger or random person except it's grocery store because nobody walks on the street. And I was kind of really fascinated about just, you know, group exercise culture and also different group of people come join this one class, have like one purpose in life during this 1 hour. So that was something I was interested in. And then pandemic happened. Even though that idea is still kind of interesting today of, you know, meeting person who's not yourself or not your friend or someone's like because we're more isolated as ever. But the pandemic happened, and for a technical reasons, that performance wasn't a good idea. And and I was just thinking about this project for quite extensive of time, that I have to change everything. But the thing is, I guess I can change the presentation, but I think my work still kind of carries this idea of community and exercising together and doing things together. So how it transformed this like a gym exercise class project transformed into this pregnant man dancing with geese kind of project is that when I was at during the pandemic for March and April, I was in this residency in New Mexico. It was, you know, isolated from civilization, was really safe. And I was really lucky to be stranded there. But then also it was a, you know, strange time to be working, but as artists living in, you know, this time that you feel pressure to be working. And I was there, you know, I was in artist residency. I have a show in the fall. I was like, I have to do something. And this is like a really interesting process of my art making process, that maybe like I'm kind of introverted, but for my art process, I like to look my ideas, subject things outside of my, like I never really stay in my studio to make work. I'm always like exploring, filming, talking to people. And, you know, it was pandemic, it was lockdown, there was nobody to talk to. I found this four geese total. And there were some ducks and other things, other creatures too, but there's four interesting geese hanging out in this abandoned golf course pond area right next to the little town I was staying. And I made it into a practice of going to film them every day. I feel like I'm like National Geography person. I don't know what I was doing. What is this project becoming? And then I just observed this, you know, whole course of four geese giving birth to egg, roosting, something, you know, things happen to the egg. They try to, you know, just like a whole course of nature during the pandemic. And that really made, kind of became the foundation or grand foundation of the piece of idea of, you know, when the world is collapsing, but then there's a egg is being made, it's giving birth. It's like, I was just like, it was really interesting moment to be observing this like geese trying to live while the world is like pandemic. So that's where I think, that's this like encounter really became the core of the project. And how I work is, so while I was filming geese, I also kind of started writing idea on the, like, so I have this notebook that I kind of take notes from everyday life, write down everything I'm interested in. And when I work on the project, it's kind of a strange simultaneous process. So I have this one notebook, I have this like observing geese part, I have this maybe planning to film a group of pregnant men dancing, and it's like three course will go simultaneous but almost parallel, and it kind of meets in the end. So in the beginning I was just like writing idea, I work with post-it a lot, moving. It's really interesting and nice to actually be able to write down all your random thought and physically kind of organize. I'm Virgo, so I like to compartmentalize like different idea and organize and make things fit like a puzzle. And then this is like another picture of like I had just like notes of video shot, notes of text, notes of ideas, and then having these things try to come together. And then before this, to this picture, which is the behind the scene of the filming, I did lots of emails organizing, casting people. And this is when we were filming the dancing, the people dancing, and I was demonstrating a yoga pose. Here's the picture of editing process. And I feel like 60% of my work is I'm just staring at the wall, like moving the post-it around and like cutting sentence and moving this back and forth. That was yeah, that was the process of making. I thought it'll be really interesting to share how things comes together during the pandemic and creative process. Well, thank you for tuning in. I'll give it back to Sandra.
Thank you so much, Yue. That was wonderful. We're going to bring everyone back, Ashley and Sarah, and pose a few questions. Ashley and I are going to pose a few questions to the artists of our own, and then we'll open it up to the rest of you. So Ashley, do you want to start with something regarding Sarah's?
Yeah, I'm wondering, Sara, if you can talk about the physicality of your work and how you use the tenor interval to really think about user perception, using the chat commands and the visuals to, you know, to produce actions based on the body.
Yeah, so I guess I think like one way is through the frame by frame interaction with the footsteps. Really kind of, I guess that's like a way to manipulate the landscape. And I guess, what was the other part of the question again?
I'm just interested in like how you use the body and the physicality to really think about time and space. And how you're...
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I guess, I mean, I guess part of like what's really important to me is having the live aspect. I think that's something that makes the work unique and really gives it like that physical quality, and something that I think helps people and the viewer really relate to, as well as kind of makes it kind of vulnerable since it's like it's happening on the spot. I know we kind of mentioned yesterday, like I was telling you guys, I feel kind of vulnerable when wearing the heart rate monitor, just because it's like you can tell if I'm anxious or really out of shape. So I think that's an interesting aspect of the work for sure.
I guess I'll follow up with a question for Yue. You actually talked quite a bit about the parallel lines of the pregnant men and the geese in your talk. But one thing I wanted to kind of hone in on was, you know, these two symbols of procreation in the video. And also there's sort of like within the narrative and some aspects of the video, sort of like a fear of being alone, and that kind of pervades our situation currently in the pandemic. There's quite a few people kind of experiencing some pretty severe aloneness they haven't before. So I was just sort of thinking about that, and then this way that the pregnant men seem almost euphoric, which of course it is euphoric often for many women when they're pregnant, but also the men seem so euphoric to be together and experiencing this thing, and isn't really until the very end when they are lying in the grass in the video and they all kind of leave one by one at once. And it made me think about a quote by Octavia Butler, where she said that we tend to slip out of togetherness the way we slip out of the womb, bloody and messy and surprised to be alone. And it that kind of sort of, I guess, weird disjuncture between this happy togetherness and then, you know, the kind of the voiceover, which is pretty dark in many parts, made me think about that And I wondered if you could comment on that. That sort of, especially the end part where it seems like they're sort of waking up to realizing that they're going to have to not be together.
Yeah, absolutely. You know, it's a great, interesting question. And I feel like how I answer, like most of my work is because my working process is like parallel and like it's like puzzle, and I'm piecing this together, that together, and see the effect. And then that, you know, produce is just like a found meaning even to me. So I think it's even for myself after editing and looking at this like juxtaposition to see what kind of meaning or, you know, idea or symbol it's like a producing by combining all those together. But the idea of this pregnant man dancing was, I guess it was continuation of this like, you know, original thing I was trying to do and I was interested in doing, but also at the same time, one of the element I've been always interested in my work is kind of representation and how to not do a representation. So I was filming these thinking about, you know, birth, egg, maternity, and like this nurturing gesture, and was thinking what can I counter? What's the like least furthest things that can be maternal is kind of older or middle-aged men in some sense. And I was kind of combining this pregnant belly with this man. Like I was, you know, I'm interested in like empathy and sympathy and how to view a diff, to empathize with something you not like you're not familiar with. So, and then the geese thing is kind of a, I'm not going to spoil, but I'm kind of spoiling. It's kind of like a tragic thing. I observed this, like this whole geese egg thing and drama with this predator. And it's something, I think this like man trying to survive with pregnant belly is kind of countering this tragedy almost and giving some, you know, humorous relief and hope by combining these two footage together. So that's something I was thinking and also thought being working within these two footages while I was editing and after, you know, viewing the work after I kind of finished the piece. And in terms of loneliness, I think something that's, whether, you know, you're alone or with your family or you, like everybody's isolated in some sense from a community today. And I guess like when I make work, it's always kind of reflect the sensibility of the moment. And I guess loneliness is not something I was particularly, you know, that wasn't really in my post-it. But as a sensibility, it was definitely maybe there, you know, subconsciously or not. And it was really interesting question in the sense I was in relations, I was thinking about bars and like people would say like, you know, you can be with people or be together at any moment of your life, but like birthing and dying, it's a solo process. Like, I guess unless you're twins, like you're not born with someone and you won't die with someone unless it's like big tragedy, I don't know. It's kind of like, you know, so it's interesting to have those two ideas next to each other. And I thought that was really interesting question.
Yeah. Thank you. Yeah, and I think you mentioned also the idea that the geese, once they lose their eggs, or a certain goose, or maybe this is all geese, that they will nest, they will continue to nest even if their eggs are gone, because they're sort of like, that there's sort of this insistence on survival, even if the circumstances have changed.
Yeah.
Very interesting. Anyway, I'm gonna shift back to Ashley and Sara. Sorry.
Thank you. So Sara, you mentioned earlier too about the vulnerability of performing and wearing the heart rate monitor. As we're watching your piece live on Twitch, we're also watching the performer kind of engage in a solo performative action where we see them get lost in their own rhythms and cycle of like working out and kind of lose themselves to the action of creating the work. And so I'm wondering how, you know, the tenor interval during these performances really explore personal and collective meditation or this idea of regenerative cycles. Cause like it's almost like the Matrix, like we're watching somebody perform who's changing screens and engaging. And so there's so many layers. So I was wondering if you can maybe elaborate on the personal and the collective and the cycles.
Yeah, definitely. I feel like I've seen it like shifting the more I've performed it. This is really kind of the first, while I've done a lot of kind of durational performance works, it's always either in the context of like a really short show or like a residency. And so I've never really done a piece like this before where it gets repeated and performed live so many times. So I think this is a really interesting experiment to see how the kind of like meditative aspect of it transforms. But I think the work is really just trying to make a space for people. I guess it creates a space for a performer. Which not at first, actually, I found, because it's interesting when you're in the apartment and you have the green screen. But I do set like an iPad in front of me so I can see the stream. And I think that helps me zone out and like kind of follow along with the landscapes. So I do find myself zoning out once I get past like the stage fright of like remembering I'm like on Twitch. But then I hope for the viewers too, I think that's why it was really important for me to bring Lisa in, since she has like experience with deep listening and creating those kind of guided meditations and sonic meditations. I think the sound is really key for the audience side, to bring them into the work as well.
Thank you.
Yeah, and I want to pick that up and just ask a question to both of you about feeling better, trying to feel better. So Sara, in your piece, there's a lot of the voiceover, it's focusing on self-awareness and care. And UA in your work, at a certain point, the narrator says outright, how can we feel better, you know, as a rhetorical question. And in both instances, this value that's placed on self-care is really part of our culture right now, but also it implies that if we don't do it, if we don't take care of ourselves, we can't take care of others. So I was thinking about that, and I was thinking about when it's in an artwork where it's virtual or you're experiencing it through the screen, something about that is interesting in terms of like that the self-care, it's a representation of self-care in a way. Like it's trying to encourage self-care, but it's also being represented, and that there's something about the performativity of that 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 I think only having an artist touch on that brings out the performativity of it, that then it like symbolizes some kind of productivity, which is of course not what the end goal of self-care is. It's like to allow yourself not be productive. I wondered if you could each comment on that.
Yeah, productivity and self-care, and it's both, I guess, present in both of our works. And it's also like you know, as I mentioned in my talk that before this piece, I was thinking about a gym, like a group exercise piece. And then I see Sara doing, it's like a solo exercise piece, but on the treadmill. It's kind of this like interesting, it's being interesting to see that this like thread that we both share, both like literally in terms of like subject and object we use, but then also theme wise. In terms of, I guess, like, you know, feeling better, self-care, that this piece was definitely for me, in a way, like a feel better piece. I was really, it was really exciting to make and fun to edit, you know, with this like a pop cheesy music and people dancing. And I think that was, like for my own practice, that was something I was excited to rediscover when you making the piece and figuring whether it's good or bad. And it's kind of almost like unprofessional to have that on your own pleasure of making. Is it fun to make, or is it, do you have joy making it? And then for this one, I think that was important of like a kind of important skill in terms of production for me. So it's kind of a feeling better piece for me, but then it's also feeling better piece as a representation of feeling better as a piece. Yeah, I don't know. It was like something I think a lot while I was making.
Yeah, and I think too, it's interesting between both our works to see like the relationship to the landscape or nature. And I feel like during this time, I feel like I've seen so much uptick in people like, you know, kind of going on hikes, going camping. And there's something about that that I feel like we're trying to like feel better. And kind of like escaping the city, and also just this aspect of like slowing down, and like all of our routines have been disrupted. And so we're kind of like relearning what's important and like, yeah, like what makes us feel better.
Thanks, Ashley.
Yeah, I'm wondering, and I'm sure this is a question on everybody's mind, is, you know, when we started out, we originally were going to have two different galleries and we were going to have two different separate shows and entrances. And so there's been a lot of twists and turns that have kind of happened. So I'm wondering both if y'all want to talk about how your projects have kind of changed over the course of the year as we've planned for something in person and then had to go back and, you know, think about safety concerns and then and because of the pandemic and how, you know, it really has been a process to get to where we are today.
Yeah, I mean, I would say, I mean, I was kind of reflecting back, Ashley, on probably like one of the first emails you sent to me. And I feel like, I don't have a quote, but I feel like it, like, let's do something about collaboration and the body and live performance and like touching and interacting. Was like the whole initial premise for the exhibition. but I think it's like interesting how it's been able to adapt, and there's still elements that I kind of miss and like hope for the future, like it can happen in a real space, but it's also been kind of rewarding to try this new avenue. And I guess, I mean, originally it was like the dripping piece was going to be in a gallery and anyone could interact with the dripper to like drip water to their own pulse. And I wanted to have the treadmill in the gallery performing with the live, like with a projection, big projection screen. So I've definitely kind of adapted it for the virtual for sure. But I think Twitch is a new medium for me. So I'm excited about that.
Anyway,
yeah, I mean, I mentioned a little bit in the talk about how, you know, the whole process or whole project changed because while I was thinking about the project and pandemic happened and, you know, have to restructure because performance is like out of the window in terms of as a method of presentation. And it's kind of really interesting to see like, oh, like it's, I never had anything directly be affected so much that to like to like imagine back that if this didn't happen, I could have made a totally different piece and seeing a totally different work. And it's definitely been challenging at a point, but then also it was kind of, I mean, how I make work is I'm just observing and, you know, what's been happening around me. And it's definitely important and the interesting moment to observe and to write and to make a piece about. It was definitely an interesting process.
I think we just answered the question that was in the Q&A from Shawana Gaffney. And then we have another question in the chat from Brianna Vargas. She says, she has a question for Sara. What led you to introduce viewer interaction to your work? And do you think you'll move more heavily towards audience interaction as your work evolves?
Yeah, that's a great question. I mean, definitely, I mean, in terms of the tender interval, the type of interaction with the custom coded chat commands is definitely like a result of COVID and like kind of adapting to that. But I think as you saw in some of in my past works, there is, a lot of times like an element of collaboration or interaction in the pieces. And for me, I found it's really important for the audience to be active in the work and participating in the work. I definitely want to keep, including that in my practice moving forward and keep using the biosensors. I think that's a really interesting way for me to include the body, but kind of take my hand out of it and just kind of include like the raw data of other people in the work, if that makes sense. I don't know if there's anything else to add to that, but for sure.
There's another question that says, can Yue and Sara give a little bit of explanation of the titles? Curious about the tenderness in Sara's title and Nonplus as the title for the overarching project of Yue's work. You know, who wants to start? Yue, what do you want to start about? What is Nonplus?
You know, Nonplus, I guess that's something you just cannot make sense of. And I guess, you know, titling process, it's an interest. I feel like everyone's process of putting title is different. My process of making title is, as I'm a post-it artist, you know, there's like, I always have this post-it of different names, ideas, word and things. So maybe I pick few and think what works or what doesn't. And also like, I guess I use this dictionary feature of, you know, you can research one word and it shows all the similar word and then you click one word and it shows all this, like it's kind of naming, it was, it's like for me, it's kind of it's like a naming puzzle game of what fits, what doesn't fit. And Nonplus, I felt like it's just a perfect for the moment, like it's just your kind of can really make sense of thing. And with my the video piece is called Recycled Air, but like the other for the outside screening, there'll be sculptural insulation. And as a whole overarching theme, for this like idea of nonsensical environment, like not able to like keep, you know, moving forward, that kind of a strange stuckness. And also it's a really interesting, like I like the look, I like all the letters, I like how it's pronounced, it's I don't know, I like the word, I guess. Yeah,
I think I have a similar process to naming. I definitely have like a word doc where I just collect words that stick out to me that I've collected through readings that I've read and things like that. In this case though, it came from a quote that I found written down in an old sketchbook. I don't even remember where I first saw it, but I'll just read the quote here from Vladimir Nabokov. Maybe the only thing that hints at a sense of time is rhythm. Not the recurrent beats of the rhythm, but the gap between two such beats. The gray gap between black beats, the tender interval. The regular throb itself merely brings back the miserable idea of measurements, but in between something like true time lurks. And so I thought that was just a really perfect, like, kind of interesting phrase that stood out. With all the different kind of intervals happening in the work, you have the interval of the time lapse, you have the interval within the body of the breathing and the heart pulse, the interval of the dripping, and really all these different kind of cycles happening in the work, and just really zoning in from also like an interest in rhythm from past works, and this kind of take with like that kind of music lens too, it kind of had. And then also I feel like the word tender, something just kind of like alludes to the body in a way. I feel like it's normally like used in relation to the body. So that phrase really stood out to me, and I thought it was a good fit for this show.
Ashley, did you have like a, like a closing question? I think we're almost out of time.
Yeah, I mean, I think one of the things that I've been thinking about both your works in terms of how they're presented and how they, you know, they both have a voiceover component. They're both kind of inherently futuristic, even though they're really rooted in kind of this moment. And I, when I'm experiencing them, I feel like I've just landed on like the platform of whatever spaceship is taking us to our next destination. And so there's something that's just like inherently for me, speculative about the work too. And so I was wondering, you know, what do y'all imagine for the future production and presentation of either this work or your future work? And like, where do you go from here?
Well, I know for me, and I can definitely, I'm also like thinking now to like you and how you like explained your process. Cause I feel like I have a similar process of like exploration and going out into the world and then coming back to the studio. But for me, I'm really actually really interested in Twitch right now, like for the real like near future. I think in terms of like a duration performance artist, that's work that's honestly like really hard to exhibit in a gallery because most galleries don't have the budget to have a live performer there full time. And that kind of work I'm really drawn to. And so I find like Twitch now, I mean, it still has its own limitations of like finding high speed internet, I guess, but it's interesting that I can, you know, start putting together these performances just from my apartment or my studio. And I think that might be like a new, like really interesting way for me to experiment. And then I also really enjoy Twitch for like the aspect of audience interaction. Kind of breaks through like that fourth wall with the audience, which as I said earlier, is also like really important for my work.
Okay, so for me, the future, you know, there's an idea of future, and then I'm going to talk about future in two ways, I guess. So like the future as an idea of like sci-fi, like concept, like I, in many of my previous works and this work too, I always kind of like to entertain the idea and think about future and think about fiction, future in a fictional way to tell a present story. I think it's a kind of strategy I often or always incorporate it in telling or critiquing maybe like issues we have today, like indirectly. So I think that's kind of element I prefer to use in this work and in previous works, and then moving that to actual future about where this work is going, that literally I have a outside screening in a month, which I'm really excited about. You will see the final iteration of the video piece, and I'm excited for, you know, the sculptural installation I'm making, but I'm also kind of really excited to be in the space in the, you know, it's outside, it's mask, it's be in a safe space to be able to see my friend or be together with all those strangers, which I think I like. While I discovered that while I was explaining my project, I like to be around with strangers, I guess. And I think people like that in this time, especially. Yep.
Yeah, I was thinking about that too, that this is actually going to be one of those like very rare, and for some people, the first experience that they will have of the arts community actually being together in the same, a very large field, a big park. It's pretty big, but still, it's kind of, it's fascinating to think how long it's been that we've been together. So anyway, looking forward to that. Looking forward to more experiences of Sara's work into November. Thank you both. Thank you, Ashley, and thank you everyone who attended this evening. Ashley, did you have a closing comment?
Oh, I was just saying, Sara's going to be really fit with all of her performances. You should have done like a workout challenge or something.
I should have looked up a marathon training schedule.
Just thank you everybody for joining us. I'm excited to see the projects online and look forward to seeing UAs in person.
Yep. Good night, everybody.
Thank you.
Thanks.